It's a slightly longish talk, but I'll try to finish it in time. It's more of a philosophical talk. You must have learned a whole lot about anatomy. You must have heard the pars, the pedicle, everything. This talk is more about what I have seen and happening in the CV junction surgery over the last 30 years. So it's like a brief recap of the whole thing and how the approaches to CV junction has changed over the last few years. So all this you must have seen, somebody must have talked about all this today, or they will in the near future. These are the problems which we encounter. Do you have a pointer? Yeah. Okay. So due to the facetal problems, there can be instability. Because of the high mobility, it is difficult to achieve adequate fixation. And if you do fix, then you restrict the motion, so you lose something, the patient has something to lose. And surgical exposure and the various techniques as just discussed by Deepak, they have a risk for the neurovascular structures, which include vertebral artery, ganglion, there could be blood loss because of the veins around the vertebral artery, and neural injury if you injure the dura or you go into the spinal canal. And that's why these are challenging. And on top of that, it might not just be bone, there may be other problems associated with the bony problem. There could be a chiari, or there could be syringomyelia or syringobulbia. So all this together can make up a CV junction problem. And once you start to address, you have to address all these problems. So before we begin, some basic terminology which you must know and remember. What is atlantoaxial dislocation? What is basilar invagination? What is cranial settling or secondary basilar invagination? What is occipitalization of atlas? And what are these lines? Most importantly, the McGregor and the McRae lines, which were the earliest. So if you, it is always good to revise again and again. We all know these definitions. What is atlantoaxial dislocation? When the C1 ring and the odontoid process, the gap between the two, if it is more than 5 millimeters, there is something wrong. Basilar invagination, you know, if the odontoid process is invaginating inside the spinal canal or the foramen magnum, there is something wrong, either a vertical or a anterior posterior problem. Occipitalization of atlas, if the C1 arch is fused to the base of the skull, you know, it's occipitalization of atlas. And these are the important lines which you must know, the McRae's and the McGregor line. They are important because they define, on based upon these lines are most of these parameters decided. Another term which is used very often is reducible versus fixed. What is reducible? What is fixed? If on extension everything comes back in place, like this patient has, when he flexes his neck, the odontoid process falls forward, the C1 falls forward, but on extension it comes back. So you know what is reducible and what is not. Now sometimes people use the word mobile or immobile, and sometimes they use the word reducible or irreducible. So how has the thinking about these problems changed? The earliest thought was fix the CV junction. You know, if it is reducible, in the reduced position, fix it, whichever way you can. Then somebody came up with the idea that no, just fixing is not enough. Sometimes it doesn't move, and if you fix it in a non-reduced position, it could be dangerous. So then came the idea of the decompress. You know, you go anterior, take out the odontoid process, and then fix. Then somebody said, no, indirect decompression. You don't directly go and attack the odontoid process, but indirectly manipulate the joint, you know, reduce it, fix it. Then came this idea. And now finally we are probably moving towards the direction that changed the joint. Just like you have a knee replacement, you can replace the hip joint. You replace the joint. Why do you need to fix it? Just replace the joint. I don't know, maybe in the future we see some new research which says how to replace the joint. So how did it all begin? It began with semi-rigid constructs. You know, take stainless steel wire, C1 and C2, somehow tie them together. It's not a rigid construct. There is no screw going into the bone. So there is always some movement. In fact, the earliest descriptions are way back in 1891. And then sutures were used by Mixter and Osgood, who incidentally also described the discectomy for the first time. Galley fixation came before the Second World War in the late 30s. C1 and C2 laminar wiring. You wire the lamina of C1 with the spinous process of C2. So these are all posterior semi-rigid constructs. And they worked well in the decades, in the late 30s and the early 40s. What is galley fixation? You all must have seen it or done it at some time or the other. There are many variations to this C1, C2 fixation. You can have the wire going under the C1 arch and fixed to the C2 spinous process. Or you can have it under the C1 arch and under the C2 arch, various things. And different people have made different modifications to this. Sontag has done something, etc., etc. But the problem in this was it does not offer stability in rotation. You know, it can still rotate. C1 and C2 can still rotate, and all these wires and things can be loose. And if it doesn't fuse, then the wires are going to break. You see, the beauty of this thing is that if you manage to hold it together for 3 months or so and it fuses, then it doesn't matter if the wire breaks. The basic idea is to fuse the bone. And that is why it worked well in quite a few cases, except there was no rotational stability. Then Brooks came along. He defined it in a slightly different way. He said, okay, you put it under the C2 spinous process, but you make two grafts, one on either side, to make it more stable so that it won't tilt. Both sides are equal. Put a graft on each side. Two rectangular bone grafts fashioned to wedge between C1 and C2. And the fusion rates with this kind of fusion were up to 93%. So it's not that they were bad. They're still good, except that rotational stability is still not there. Then Dickman and Sontag defined it further. They said you loop it below the C2 second sublaminar wire. Add two wires, one on each side of the midline. It becomes more stable. It's not just one loop. It's two loops, one on either side. This was the last modification. And if you want to avoid going sublaminar at C2, you can use the spinous process, which is quite big. And you can make a small groove under it and fix the wire there. And this avoids passing second sublaminar wire under C2. So it makes it slightly safe. Then somebody came up with Halifax clamps. You know, they said, okay, you can put one clamp on C1, one clamp under C2, and like a claw, you fix it together. And this will hold it together. And this too worked well. But it wasn't possible in some cases. If the C1 ring is fractured or if there is some anatomical malformation, this wouldn't work. And sometimes the screw became loose, the hook slipped off, etc., etc. So there were problems with all. And even from our country, in cases where there is occipitalized atlas, Dr. Jain from SGPGI described a technique which said, okay, you make an artificial arch. You make holes near the foramen magnum in the occipital bone to fashion a kind of C1 arch, and then you fix the occiput or the false C1 arch to C2. So this was Jain's technique, and this was published way back in 97. This worked well too. So even in occipitalized atlas, you could actually do a wiring technique to fix. Then came some semi-rigid constructs. The problems with semi-rigid constructs, we've just heard that. And then came Dr. Magal, who described the transarticular screw. You must have heard Deepak's talk, and he talked a lot about the anatomy and what exactly is transarticular screw. And if you see, the interesting thing in Dr. Magal's technique was that you have these two screws on either side, so you immobilize the joint, and you have a midline graft. So you have a three-point stability. You have a three-point fixation. And as you know, a three-legged stool is quite stable. It's difficult in two legs, but in three-legged stool, it's definitely more stable, and it gives, it stops the rotational movement as well. And this worked well, and Dr. Magal published a huge series of 160 odd patients with hardly any I think less than 1% injury to the vertebral artery, and he said it's very safe. And this became very popular. But then soon people realized that this loop, this vertebral artery over here, can be dangerous, and the vertebral artery can be injured. And there is a learning technique to this. It takes time, there is a learning curve. And very few people were able to reproduce the results of Dr. Magal. So it soon became, oh, this is very dangerous, it's complicated, you need a learning technique, you need some time to learn it. So it didn't become as popular as it was when Magal actually first talked about it. It was way back in 86, and these were some of the problems associated with this. The biggest problem being this vertebral artery groove. And the space left for your screw is this much. So if this groove is very deep, then you have very little of the pedicle left, and it's difficult to put a screw there. And so the incidence of vertebral artery injury has been reported as high as 30% in some series which have been published. So that's because of either something wrong with the technique, or if you don't study the anatomy carefully and you find this pedicle is too narrow, you're likely to injure the vertebral artery. Now, so then after all this, people thought that, okay, just doing posterior is dangerous. Sometimes it doesn't work. And so that's why you have to go anterior. And, you know, in fact, the earliest report about transvolar surgery was Canavel had reported it way back in the 1920s. But Menezes was the one who actually got it right in the mainstream, huge publications, how to do a transoral, the technique, the complications, etc., etc. He actually re-established transoral surgery in the 80s in the world. And so it became very popular. And there have been series from India, from China, from Russia, hundreds of patients who went dealt with by transoral, and it worked quite well. It does work. Again, there is a learning curve. Again, there are some problems in transoral surgery. Again, sometimes the access is difficult, but it did work. And there are many surgeons who have had very satisfying results doing transoral surgery. And these are some of the approaches, which were described and which can be taken. You may sometimes need to split the palate if it is too high, or you may have to do a leaflet. You actually go through the maxilla, or sometimes through the mandible, split the tongue. All kinds of operations have been described, and all anterior approaches to deal with the odontoid directly, or deal with the offending bone directly, maybe the C2 body or the odontoid. Then came descriptions of odontoidectomy. Like I said, Menezes had described it. You can again find everything in literature. I don't think there's any need to repeat it, but here are some of the pictures, what it looks like through the microscope. You need some good drills, you need a good monopolar cautery, and an understanding of anatomy, and you should be fine. Doing a transoral, once you're over the learning curve, there is no problem. And then some people said that if you can do a transoral through a microscope, why can't you do it through an endoscope? And people have actually tried and successfully demonstrated, published, that even endoscope can be used to do transoral surgery, and they have done it. And some people still do it, especially there is a center in San Francisco, that Sardarji, I think Harjeet Singh is his name. He has published two or three times, and he always talks about it, that endoscopic, either through the nose or through the mouth, there's no need to put all these funny retractors. You do it through the endoscope, and it works equally well. Well, we don't have much experience with the endoscope, especially for transoral. But it's not that the transoral surgery doesn't have complications. So many things can happen. The CSF may leak, you may injure the cord, meningitis may happen, the pharyngeal wound may open, the vertebral artery is not very far from here, so secondary hemorrhages, all kinds of things have happened. So it's not that transoral surgery is very simple. And then came the era of rigid constructs. By rigid, I mean a screw going into bone. That's the basic fundamental difference between a rigid construct and a semi-rigid construct. A rigid construct has a screw going into the bone, another screw going into another bone, and a rod fixing the two screws together. That is a rigid fixation. Then came this era of rigid fixations. They started putting screws everywhere, and Magels was part of this rigid fixations. Sometimes people still use contoured rod or a plate rod. All these things were used. We have used a lot of these. Then came Dr. Goyal's revolutionary paper. He said, all this occiput, cervical, no need. You fix C1 and C2 together. And believe me, he was the earliest person to actually talk about it. And a few years later, Dr. Magel did the same thing, but he did it with screws. Dr. Goyal did it with a plate and smaller screws. But the concept originally was the same, that you fix the C1, C2 joint together. You scrape out the soft tissue from the joint, you pack it with bone, you put little, Dr. Goyal uses little screws, small screws, 2.5 mm screws, and a plate to hold this thing together. And once the joint fuses, there is no need for all these implants. And the same thing was described by Dr. Magel, except that, by Dr. Harms, except that he put screws. And so now this technique goes by the name of Goyal and Harms, Goyal-Harms technique, when you fix the two together. This was what the Goyal's original technique looked like. You put a screw in the C1, you put a screw in the C2 parts, and there is a small plate which connects the two, and you put bone graft inside the joint, and it works very well. And he has published tremendous series over the last 10-15 years showing excellent results. Harms, while Harms technique used this screw, you must have heard Deepak's talk, so I won't go into the anatomy, but essentially it's the same thing, C1 screw, C2 screw, and getting joined together with a graft in the middle. So the advantages and disadvantages of every procedure. So you disrupt the ligamentous complex. You have to take off everything to see all this. The C2 root sometimes get damaged, or you may have to cut it sometimes. Sometimes it bleeds a lot because of the veins. And anatomy is difficult, so it again there is a learning curve, and you need some time to learn about it. So this is the pictures from the original Harms paper, which was published describing his technique. Now you have heard a lot about the other methods of fixation. You can use this rigid technique. Even if the pars is a problem, you can use the lamina. So the C2 screw can be in the lamina, C1 screw can be where it usually is, and you can still get a fixation of C1 and C2. Then came the idea of joint manipulation, that not just fix the joint, you can actually manipulate it. So for basilar invagination, you don't need anything else. You distract the joint and you can get the basilar invagination joint, basilar invagination reduced. And way back in 2006, Wang had first done a capsulotomy. He said, first remove the capsule of the joint, make them mobile, and then maybe you can do without anterior surgery. So the whole idea of this manipulation was to avoid anterior surgery. And finally, Sharad had described this technique in 2013, the DCER, which most of you must have read about it. So the idea is that by just manipulating the joint, you get a 360 degree, X, Y, Z, all three axes. And he's trying to develop this, what is it called, reducer, universal reducer, am I right? Yeah, universal reducer. And maybe you'll soon see it. And so all these manipulations of the joint will become very easy once the universal reducer, you do the measurements, you fix the reducer, and it can move your joint in X, Y, Z axis. Let's see what happens in future. And for this, before that, he also described some new joint indices. I'm sure you must have read all the indices. I described the earliest ones, the McGregor lines and the Macri lines, but there are some new indices as well, which help you decide which procedure to adopt. The basic idea being the verticality of the joints, the C1, C2 joints, if they are parallel to the floor or not. As long as they are parallel or near parallel, you can do all this. But if the joints are vertical, then it's very difficult to fix those two and have something sticking there, because gravity will keep on acting on it and it won't stay. So in case the joints are vertical, you can still go ahead with occipital cervical fusion and anterior surgery. And these are the different joint indices which were described. Some of the results. Then somebody from PGI, Praveen, in fact described comprehensive facetal drilling. You just drill the bone away, you make the joint in the shape you want. Even if the joints are vertical, you drill away the bone. You know, he he actually wrote, this is from his paper, you drill away all this and you make the surfaces flat and then you put a spacer, and so there is, you can still avoid anterior surgery even there is a vertical joint. That's what he described, and that's how the spacer would look like after you drill away everything. But this always makes me wonder, if you see the bone here, this is the cortical bone and the rest is all cancellous bone. If you drill away the cortical bone, your graft is going to rest on cancellous bone. I always wonder what is going to happen to that graft. You know, it's going to sink. Something is going to subside. And if there is movement, then the whole load is going to come on the screws and it's going to fail. So this kind of a thing always makes me scared. But it is published. It's there in the literature. That you reshape the joints, you put in a spacer, and you can still do, even if the joints are vertical. But there are difficulties, as we discussed, you know, every operation has advantages or disadvantages. Then some people said, why go from the back if it is so dangerous? Why can't you manipulate the joint from the front? You can go anteriorly, and anteriorly there's hardly anything. It's quite safe. You can distract the joint, you can put in a spacer, you can fix. And all these people have published, and what's his name, from Pune, Patkar. Patkar from Pune keeps talking about this. He says, oh, posterior roll is not necessary. Most of the times you can do anteriorly. You can go from here, submandibular, and reach the C1, C2 joint. You can manipulate it, you can distract, you can graft, and you can fix. And it's so easy. But me, I don't have much experience with the anterior approach, so I won't talk about it. But it's just for your learning that there is another thing available, that is the anterior approach. And he has described, this is from one of his publications, all kinds of things are possible anteriorly. And see, there is enough space, enough bone, and no dangerous thing nearby. So you can actually fix it anteriorly. And he has claimed that he can manipulate the joints and reduce basilar invagination as well anteriorly. So now looking back, what are the goals of surgery? You have to correct the facetal malalignment. The problem is at the facet joint. Whichever way you correct it, posteriorly, anteriorly, by taking off the odontoid and removing the offending bone, somehow you have to try and get over this facetal malalignment. Second, you need to fuse. There has to be a graft which is incorporated with C1 and C2. That's where you have to stop. The goal is arthrodesis, stable bony fusion. And to get a stable bony fusion, you need the implants. So whether it's a rigid or semi-rigid screw in the C1, C2, occiput, doesn't matter. The idea is to fuse C1 and C2, whichever way you do it. Posterior, anterior, doesn't matter. You drill the joint, don't drill the joint. Do what you have to, or what you can safely do. But the idea is to get a stable bony fusion. And so, this must be coupled with decompression. So if there is something compressing the neural structures, you have to decompress it. So these three essentially are the goals of your surgery. You have seen so much, you will see some more on cadaver. You have heard of all these techniques. You must decide for yourself what works better for you and use that technique to fuse your patients and to bring about good clinical result. Thank you very much for your attention.